Yes, it's our network security session this morning. So.
And I probably want to switch off one of these mics.
Yes. Okay. Hello. Now this is a bit awkward. Now you've got a guy in a suit talking about security and network operations. I was planning on swapping my clothing, but I didn't make it. So sorry for that. But yeah, I do have some operational experience. PC asked me to talk about security, and of course it's important. But the other thing I want to talk about is actually the importance of the registry, because everybody sort of recognizes RIPE NCC like, oh yeah, they're the guys you get an IP address, they're the guys that you can get ASNs from. But there's more to it. What's the function of a registry now IPv4 has run out? And that's what I want to talk a bit about here. How can you use the information that sits in the registry, in the Whois system, in the RPKI system, to actually secure your network? And this is just a short primer, because there's a lot to talk about. So my colleague Alex Bond, who will arrive tomorrow night, is going to do a 3-hour long tutorial on Tuesday about RPKI and about how to use this system to secure your network. So if you want to know more, please join him for the tutorial. Important that Philip already hinted to this morning is that a lot of the so-called attacks you see on a day-to-day basis are actually just stupid mistakes. There's a lot of people just messing up typos. They swap two numbers in an IP address and everything goes south. So keep in mind Handler's Razor. It may as well just be somebody making a typo. So what's a route hijack in the context of this talk? Imagine you're the blue guy and you've got 10/8. Well, obviously you haven't, but you're announcing that to the world, sourcing it from your AS. And along comes the orange person and says like, "Hey, I'm ASY. I'm somebody else, and I've got 10/16. Who would win if I send traffic to it?" Remember, every routing table is set up to take the most specific match. So all the traffic in that first /16 will end up at the orange guy. Which obviously makes stuff break, which you don't want. So how to detect this? And this is actually much more complex as it may seem. Because detecting a hijack, detecting something like this, well, you can monitor your routing table, which by now contains about 500,000 routes. Continuously keep pulling everything from your router, parsing it to scripts, finding out that somebody is setting up your or messing with your prefixes. The second point, it's a bit controversial, and I went to lengthy discussions in my previous job with the security guy, because he said, no, you should never accept BGP announcements for your own space. And I was like, well, what if we do? We accept the route, and we just simply prevent traffic from flowing. If somebody announces accidentally a more specific of my IP space, things will simply break, and our customers will notice, and hopefully our monitoring will be there first. We know that something's wrong, we can look into it. Yeah, but we can use a third-party service to monitor that. Yeah, I've heard that before. And I talk to people and I'm like, yeah, what happens if it does? Yeah, it sends me an email. Well, wait a minute, if somebody is announcing your IP space, will that email ever reaches you? So this is actually quite a complex situation. It may sound so easy, I'll just prevent somebody from sending your IP space to somebody else. But it's actually quite complex. So how to solve it? Oh yeah, and don't allow traffic to flow. Little sidestep. Is there any reason ever why an IP packet destined for IP space that sits in your network should leave your network? Probably not, unless you've got some really fancy BGP setup in which you transit to another AS to reach part of your network. Even then you could probably use more specific. So the answer is no, and that's the actual case. you might want to set up a little filter preventing that from happening, making sure that nobody can redirect traffic and basically do a man-in-the-middle attack. So here's a little snippet. It can be as simple as that. Let's say you have an uplink and you've got 10/8, then something like this should do the basic trick of preventing those packets from escaping your network. It's a general sense of security, and of course you can also apply this to IPv6. This is not an IPv4 only talk. RPKI. Everybody's talking about it, and MNOC after MNOC, I've done RPKI tutorials in the past and presentations about it. Yes, RPKI was specifically designed to stop these things from happening. But RPKI is really complicated to set up, and you have to upgrade your network and have to configure everything. In the end, RPKI fits into your BGP flow, and your router can make the own decision like, hey, this is coming from the wrong source. Let's not accept this route. But there is an easy way around if it's all you want is detecting. The RIPE NCC validator, if you run it standalone on your machine, will actually connect back to the RIPE NCC a few times a day and get a copy of the internet routing table, which we built using RIS, Route Information System. And Christian probably later on today or tomorrow will talk a bit more about that system. And using that standalone validator, and it has some APIs, you can actually see that something is entering the routing table that shouldn't be there. So even if you're not running RPKI directly on your routers, you can still use this system to detect and prevent hijacks. It will alert you, and you can look into it. The other thing you can do is once you set up RPKI is actually configure in the RIPE NCC portal, say like, hey, alert me when there's something wrong with these prefixes. If an invalid shows up, tell me. But then again, that applies, yeah, if it does happen, make sure that we can still reach you, that alert will reach you. So you might want to, for instance, send it not only to your own company account, but to a third-party mail server. The malicious version. The stuff I talked about so far, somebody from another AS announcing your space. That's probably most likely a typo. Because if I'm evil, and there we have Mr. Evil, I can, of course, also spoof the AS source. And if I announce a more specific coming from ASX, I still get all the traffic. But nobody on the internet will see the difference, right? So when I'm evil, put your ASN in the pod, and for sure you will never see the updates, because BGP is designed not to re-announce space to an ASN it's already passed. And at the same time, everybody else has got no reason to believe it's not me. I can trust the ASN, right? This is really hard to troubleshoot, and this is really hard to prevent, because, oh, one too far. RPKI in its current form, and yes, people are discussing how to do router by router security, full pod validation in RPKI, but that's nowhere near completion. And in the meantime, RPKI's most important feature is filtering on ASN origin. And you can filter out more specific. So you've got some form of protection, but not everything. So how do you prevent it? Well, somewhere on the internet, somebody has to provide that attacker with an uplink. Somewhere, somebody says, okay, yes, thank you, I'll take your BGP announcement and I will spread it across the internet. I will propagate that route. It makes sense to filter your customers. Make sure that the only thing they announce is the IP space that's assigned to them, and it's coming from the ASN that's assigned or allocated to him. Oh, and of course, filter also your own things. But remember, most attacks are simply mistakes. Your customer can just make a stupid typo, and all of a sudden, a whole airline disappears off the internet. In the end, in summary, it's a matter of please don't litter. Keep your community clean. Because as Philip talked about it this morning, when he gave the Mongolian example, filtering on your transits is really hard. Because you can't possibly keep up with all the changes and all the updates on the internet. And sooner or later you will find out that somewhere there's a mistake in your filtering announcements that you shouldn't. But you've got a direct relationship with your customer. You're talking with the guy. You've got a contract with the guy. So that's where the easy bit is. So current practices in BGP. Filter all incoming announcements. Just make sure that your customer can't make any typos, and if they do, they get filtered. Filter all your outgoing BGP announcements. That's the other BGP. Because, yeah, it might be your customer making a typo. It could also be you on a rainy Monday morning, lacking coffee, or one of your colleagues. That way, if everybody applies this logic to the edges, you can don't have to filter the core of the internet. You can leave your transits and your peerings, which are much more complex to filter, which are much more complex to keep up to date, left alone. Using the right database as a source. Like I said, there's another function to this registry. The right database doubles as a so-called internet routing registry. People can say, this is my IP space, and it should only be announced by this ASN. Your customers can do the same. So instead of just believing the customer when he says, oh, can I announce this IP space? Why not double check it with the right database? And you can create prefix filters based on that information. Now, a lot of people think like, oh, this is really complex and I need a lot of expensive tools and big scripts and everything. But when you're just provisioning a single-homed or maybe a multi-homed stub customer, so a customer that doesn't have any networks behind him, just a simple, here's my ASN, here's my prefix. This simple whois query that's in the bottom, which will run on any Linux server, Mac. I haven't tested it on Windows because I don't have a Windows box anymore, but I'm sure it will work. Let's say your customer is AS3333. If you run this command, it will give you all the prefixes that should come from this ASN. It's a one-line Unix command, and you can verify that whatever your customer is telling you is correct. And the right database mirrors the other registries. So the little dash A there tells it to also look for information that might have come from APNIC or Aaron or another region. It's as simple as this. Please do so. On a side note, and I already talked about it, is there any reason why a packet destined for your network should leave your network? No. Similar question. Is there any reason why a packet using a source address that doesn't live in your network should ever leave your network? This is what's called BCP38, and it's preventing source address spoofing. And a gentleman from Tata talked about DDoS attacks. And most of these DDoS attacks we see are using spoofed addresses. People manage to send packets off the internet with IP addresses that they don't have, they do not own. Because for a DDoS, you're never interested in the reply. All you want is as much traffic as possible to your target without actually revealing your source. Set up filters to drop these packets. Now, common access concentrators, dial-up systems, DSLAMs, or you know, the cable headends have functionality like that built in. A customer usually can't use anything. Remember that it also applies to, for instance, VPS servers and data centers, because that's what we see is a lot of lacking. People, oh, I'll trust my VPS. No, you can never trust anything, not the system, not the person, and when it comes to security. So prevent that. Set up simple filters and block these things. Other little trick you can do in your network is unicast reverse path forwarding. It's a mouthful. Basically, what this system does, and most Ciscos, most Junipers, and pretty much every modern router has equal functionality, it will only accept a packet when it has a route for the source address. And you can run it in two modes, strict, and that way it will only accept a packet coming in on an interface if the actual route to the source address is back out to that interface. Your customer will only be able to send packets into your network if it's his IP space, if it's routed to him. Now, obviously, for multi-homing, that doesn't work. So for multi-homing, we've got something called loose mode. That's much more tolerant. It will prevent people from sending packets that are not in the routing table. It's slightly more. Obviously, this will only work if you don't have a default route. Because if you've got a default route, there will always be a route outside of the router for that destination. So then it doesn't make any sense. But this is useful things to set up in your core. I'm reaching the end. The post-mortem, analysis of incidents. When it's going on or when things break, remember, outside of all the assignment and allocation information, we collect a lot of data, and Christian will spend his talk explaining how we collect them and what can be done with it. But remember, we've got a lot of information about also about the BGP table, and we can link that to the RIPE database. So we've got one interface called RIPEstat. You can go into it, and you can also look at historic data. So when something broke, you can find the source, and you can give them a call or send them an email saying, hey, watch it. Can you please make sure that you filter your announcements? Or maybe not call that guy, but call his upstream saying like, hey, what happened here? Can you make sure that things are filtered? So there's a lot of stuff outside of getting IP addresses or getting ASNs from the RIPE NCC that you can use the registry for. And that ties into final point is make sure that registry is up to date. Kasai this morning in his keynote talked a bit about gray markets. Remember that within the service region, if you transfer IP addresses, that's a lot. You can actually, if you go out and buy IP addresses, make sure to update the registry, because other people rely on the information in this registry to, for instance, set up their filtering. And please make sure that your customers keep their information up to date. So, with that, and realizing that I'm standing, I think, between you and lunch, I'm happy to take a few questions. And that's probably, that killed all the questions, right? I mentioned the lunch, I said food, and then nobody has a question anymore. Really? Was I that clear, or was I that unclear? It's then always the scary bit if you don't get questions.
No, people are that hungry.
Or people are that hungry. I think I'll settle for that one then. Of course, I'll be around here for the next 3 days and also helping out with a few tutorials. So if you've got any questions, do feel free to talk to me in the breaks.
Okay, if there are no questions, thanks very much, Marco.
Thank you.
Thank you. So we'll resume in an hour from now. So please come back, 2 p.m. Lunch is where you had the tea break, coffee break, but just keep on going. It's the next room beyond that. So please enjoy your lunch, and we'll see you back here at 2 p.m. Thanks very much. And the speakers for the sessions this afternoon, please make sure your slides are on the speaker laptop so you have the lunch break to do that.